You have a big love for basketball as well. So how do you frame Kobe? MJ Light?
Yeah, definitely. I'm a Laker fan, so I was at that game too when they threw the alley-oop.
You were?
Oh yeah, that was a good memory. What I love most about Kobe is that killer instinct, that Black Mamba, that win at all costs, and that's been kind of an inspiration as I've watched him over the years. Like, his work ethic is unbelievable. Stories of him going to the gym at 2 o'clock in the morning or getting 1,000 makes before he'd leave the gym, working out after the game. There's a reason why this guy is one of the best ever.
Well, it's interesting. When you broke into the NFL in Kansas City, and you averaged about 85 catches in your career a year, and that's with Tyler Thigpen. If you'd have had Tom Brady, you'd have been a 130. Your numbers would have been absolute. No, I mean, nobody doubts that. If Gronk played with Andy Dalton, he's not as good as he is with Tom Brady. But when you broke into the league, you started slowly. Like, we were talking about Lonzo Ball, and then you all of a sudden you clicked. Was it work ethic? Was it speed of the game? Was it confidence? Like, how did it change for you?
Well, after I had my second year in the league, I dropped, as I've told you this story before, I dropped 17 footballs, had a horrible year, got benched a couple games. That offseason, I started reading and started learning about guys like this, guys like Michael Jordan, you know, Barry Sanders, Jerry Rice, their work ethic, and I realized I wasn't putting enough work. So I changed my whole routine, started catching, instead of catching 15 balls a day, I started catching around 300 balls a day. And imagine, you know, by the game time, you know, imagine what happens. Mentally, you have to change it too. You have to say to yourself, instead of doubting yourself, you have to walk in with all the confidence in the world. That's indicative, and the hallmark of every champion is they have an unbelievable, unshakable confidence, which I had to develop.
Yeah, I was going to say, it's funny. When I first met you, you asked me, I remember we were sitting at lunch, and you're like, you're really confident. You talked for 3 hours. Where did you get that? You're fascinated by confidence.
Fascinating.
Since I've met you, if somebody said, what's Tony Gonzalez like? I'd say very thoughtful, much more thoughtful than the average pro athlete, and he's really into the confidence thing.
I love the confidence. I love seeing what makes great people tick. Why you? Why Colin Cowherd versus another guy?
You're acting now. Yeah. So you literally, you're doing some acting on the side. So you weren't confident the first time you stood.
I got crushed. As you know, I did Triple X, which was a billion-dollar movie. I don't know if you know that. But so anyway, I did that movie, and then I started, okay, I'm going to start acting again because I took a couple of years off. And so I started going off to these auditions.
Right.
And I think I told you the story. So I get to one audition, and I'm sitting there, and I'm just doing – it is bad. I am bombing. Like, I can't remember any word. And I got done reading it, and I looked up at the lady, and I'm like, oh, that was freaking horrible. And she goes, yeah, that was freaking horrible. And she agreed with me. And so I'm sitting out in the car after the auditions. Or, by the way, she gave me a hug when I left the room. So I'm sitting out in the car, and I'm thinking to myself, like, what the hell am I doing? Why do I want to be an actor? Yada, yada. You're going through all these questions. Like, we all go through that self-doubt. And I realized, first of all, I wasn't putting in the work, and it was like the same exact thing happened to me as I did my second year. I'm not putting in the work. I think I'm working hard, but I'm not working hard. And also, when I'm walking in those rooms, I am not having that confidence because I'm not working hard, which is not giving me that confidence. So it's changed everything as far as my approach to acting now. And it's the same thing that I did when I played football. And it's a lot of things that the failure is a good thing. You know, being challenged is a good thing. And I think that's what happens to a lot of people that are great at what they do. They always go through some type of downturn where they learn from it, and then they come back even stronger.
It's interesting. A story broke today with Mike Lombardi, who said Bill Belichick will bench players who reach for the goal line, who reach or lunge, knowing you could have a touchback or the ball will be bobbled. And I thought, God, only Belichick on this play.
Yeah.
Would have a freak out and bench you if you did that. They're so detailed. They're so prepared. When I looked at this game, though, what was remarkable to me, Tony, is after the decision was made, how frantic the Steelers looked. Go 14 years in the league, and Big Ben looked like he had a panic attack.
Yeah.
That's what jumped out to me. It wasn't just the play. It was, okay, there was a four-minute review. You came out and looked lost. That's why, does it bother you that Big Ben called out Tomlin? And he's acting as if, hey, you know, I was going to do this. There was a lot of communication stuff. Like, shouldn't Big Ben be better in that spot?
Yeah, he should be better. I mean, I think if you saw after the game, Aaron Rodgers did not play well. And he came out and said it. It was like, hey, it's not the fairy tale ending that I wanted. I got to play better. I threw three picks. I did not do well. And I'll take the blame. And I think this is something he should do. He should come out and say, you know what, we got a little frantic. It's not how we wanted to end it. We're going for the win. And I get what Ben Roethlisberger is going through. Put yourself in that position. These guys have been coming down, kicking your butt throughout the years, and you're finally in a position to go out there and win the game. He just lost it, and he usually doesn't. He's better in this. He's been better in this, and I hope he will be better in this. So the way he handled that, I don't think that was right. I think that's something you just keep in house and keep your mouth shut and just take the blame.
I want to talk about the Seahawks. You have never been when we had you and I went somewhere. Oh, we went to the Cal game together, USC Cal game. And we're in the car. We just landed in the airport, and we were driving to the game. And you told a story to me, and I think it was private, but I think I can address this, that you were not outspoken as a player, that you probably hurt yourself for a couple years in Kansas City. You towed the company line. You were not outspoken. You were not political. And in the end, it probably hurt your numbers in your career, although you're going to be a first-ballot Hall of Famer. Seattle's the opposite. When they put all these young guys together, they were quiet and focused and passionate. Now they're all political. He brings in Dwayne Brown and Sheldon Richardson, both guys who can be Sheldon's had problems getting along with teammates. Sherman, Michael Bennett, a lot of chatter. ESPN article, ripping Russell. When I look at the Seahawks, to me, I'm like, that's just too much noise. How does it land for you? Do you like that seemingly everybody's got a brand, everybody's got an opinion? Bobby Wagner and Earl Thomas are ripping each other after the game. I don't see that with New England. I just don't see it with the Spurs. I don't see it with the St. Louis Cardinals. Seattle and Pete Carroll, it's Mardi Gras.
Yeah.
Like, everybody's got their own party. Do you like it? Because you seem so – you are a toe-the-company-line guy a lot.
Yeah. Yeah. Well, you like it, and as a player, that's the environment that you kind of want to be in because it's so much fun. Because it's so much fun. And when you're winning, it's great. It's great, but as soon as things start to fall apart, like they're falling apart for them, that's when people start, like us, we start talking about it. They get frustrated with each other. They get frustrated with themselves. They're not happy. And right now, I think you're watching a team that is, that immaturity is coming out now because they don't know how to handle this.
They haven't been on this road. And also, Tony, they haven't lost much in the last 6 years.
Yeah, that's what I'm saying. They don't know how to handle this. This is totally new. And we talked about it yesterday on Speak for Yourself, where when you're losing, and I've been, and I know how to lose. I've been on some losers. You do that. You start asking questions. You start saying, well, this guy doesn't care. All he cares about driving around is Bentley, or he wants to just go out and go to clubs, or he just cares about, you know, the sound bite, you know, for when the camera's on. You see him perk up, and you start looking at those little things that you kind of glossed over before because you're winning. Now you're losing. Now you're like, that's why. This is why. And you start looking for reasons.
So you've been in locker rooms where it starts to the thread count, it unravels.
Yeah, it unravels quick, and success brings this. I mean, we had a guy on our team who went out and he had an unbelievable season, an all-pro type season. Then he comes back and he's getting driven in a Rolls Royce by a driver to and from practice and all that stuff, and starts, you know, showing up late for meetings, because success is a disease sometimes if you let it get to you. And then when you start losing and now those stats aren't coming like they used to, you start to get frustrated, and then you act like a baby even more. It's immaturity, and this is what Bill Belichick does. He checks that at the door. That ego is, I think it's probably written on the, check your ego at the door, and you're going to come to work. And if here, you talked about his system versus other people's system. The Bill Belichick system is know what to do. I think that's his first and one of his two first and foremost rules is know what to do. If you don't know what to do, you're out of here. You're going to get cut. And then come in and we're going to put you in a position to be successful. I think that's how he coaches. And the system around most other teams, they coach around their system. That's what I think I'm sure we'll probably talk about Matt Ryan. That's what I think is going on over there. He's having all these different systems coming in instead of putting him in a position to be successful, and I think that's why he struggles sometimes.
Good seeing you, Tony Gonzalez. Hi, everybody, and thanks for watching. We want you to subscribe here, to get the latest from the show. Also, be sure to check out more of the best clips from The Herd, or go watch a few segments from the newest show on FS1, First Things First with Chris Carter and Nick Wright.